LegalizeFreedom.com. Why are we here? Where do we come from? Where are we going? From the nature of reality to the future of humanity. Beyond politics, poverty, and war. LegalizeFreedom.com.
The sword from the stone, he shall be king.
We have won battles against armies. Now one man defeats all my armies.
Use the magic.
Do it. Nobody shall have the sword. Nobody shall wield Excalibur but me.
Ready my knights for battle. They will ride with their king once more. Now, my brother, I shall be king.
Greetings and welcome once again to LegalizeFreedom.com. I'm your host Greg Moffat, and my guest today is Graham Phillips, who joins us to discuss his book, The Lost Tomb of King Arthur, The Search for Camelot and the Isle of Avalon. The story of King Arthur is known throughout the world. The fabled Camelot, Sir Bedivere casting Excalibur into the lake, and Arthur's secret burial at the Isle of Avalon. These are just a few of the enchanting themes in the ancient saga that historians have long considered to be pure fantasy. Now, in The Lost Tomb of King Arthur, Graham Phillips presents compelling evidence that such legends were actually based on real events. During a quest lasting over 25 years, he has followed a fascinating trail of historical clues showing Arthur to have been a living warrior who led the Britons around the year 500. He has discovered that the legendary Camelot, Excalibur, and Avalon were based on a real city, a real sword, and a real island. And, most astonishing of all, Graham has found what he claims to be the location where Arthur was finally buried, an ancient manuscript still preserved at Oxford University, Graham believes, reveals the whereabouts of King Arthur's long-lost tomb, not in the southwest town of Glastonbury, as the popular myth maintains, but at an ancient site in the isolated countryside of central England. With the help of archaeologists employing the very latest scientific techniques, the author now has what he is certain is the final proof that this disregarded Dark Age text really does reveal the last resting place of the man behind the legend of King Arthur. Hello and welcome, Graham, and thank you so much for joining us today on LegalizeFreedom.com.
Thank you very much for having me on.
Graham, today we're going to be talking a little bit about your new book, which is entitled The Lost Tomb of King Arthur, The Search for Camelot and the Isle of Avalon. Before we dive into that, just tell listeners a little bit about your background and your work in general.
I've investigated historical mysteries for about 30 years, and I think I've had about 15 books published. I've lost count now. But these historical mysteries are generally looking for lost historical artifacts like the Ark of the Covenant or the Holy Grail, and the historical figures have been people like Robin Hood, Alexander the Great, and in this case, King Arthur.
In general, the figure of King Arthur is world famous. This, for most people's money, a mythological figure. And of course, over the years, there's been a lot written about, did he have some basis in reality? Were the Arthurian myths drawn from something that was perhaps lost in the mists of time and got added to and taken away from and embellished over the years, as often happens with myths? The first time I came across the idea of King Arthur, the figure of King Arthur, I don't exactly remember what it had been. It would have been in childhood, probably in some, picture book. But the first time I clearly remember having articulated was, it was almost simultaneously several things happened when I was at university. I saw John Berman's 1981 film Excalibur, which for a lot of people is kind of like archetypal, because it is very much based on the ideas in Sir Thomas Malory's Le Mort d'Arthur, again, which is something I came across at university. Basically, what we have here are rather unlikely romantic tales from the medieval era, and they have cemented what in most people's minds are the literary and the visual aspects, and indeed, the narrative aspects of the Arthur story. And it's really trying to get past that in the first instance is the first big hurdle in people's minds.
Historians tend to steer clear of investigating King Arthur, so do archaeologists, primarily because of the reasons that you just said. They think of King Arthur as like this very mythical, romanticized figure that's portrayed in what are called the Arthurian romances of the Middle Ages, written between around about 1150 up until the point of the author you talked about, Sir Thomas Malory and his Mort d'Arthur, in the middle 1400s. So over this few century period, these elaborate stories of King Arthur are written, which are very well outlined in the John Borman Excalibur film. And you've got Arthur as a knight in shining armour. You've got magical things coming into the story, like damsels in distress, fighting dragons, Merlin the magician, and all this sort of thing. And obviously that particular character did not exist as an historical figure. What I've tried to do is to look behind those legends and to find out where they came from. Were they just simply made up in the Middle Ages, or was there some earlier story that they based these tales upon? And I've discovered, as have other historians, that going back to what called the Dark Ages, the period between when the Roman Empire collapsed in the 400s and the Romans left Britain, and the medieval period, which starts around about 1066, you've got a period where there was much conflict and anarchy in many parts of Britain. The Romans had left. Britain had divided up into a series of separate kingdoms. There was invasions from Anglo-Saxons, from Germany, and by Danes and Vikings from Scandinavia. And Britain was in a right state. And this period is known popularly as the Dark Ages. And during this period, a number of tales were written about King Arthur, well before the stories that we now know that make up the romanticized Arthur. But these earlier references to Arthur refer to him as a pretty much down-to-earth warlord. The earliest of these was written around about 830 AD. A monk called Nennius wrote not actually a story, but what he claimed to be a history of the British. And in that, he refers to King Arthur being a man who united the kingdoms of Britain in their fight against the invading Anglo-Saxons. Because at that time, the Britons were primarily Celts. The Anglo-Saxons, who we now think of as the English, invaded the country from Germany. And he talks about Arthur being the last of the native British kings to make a really successful stand against the Anglo-Saxons around about 500 AD. And he doesn't embellish this story with dragons and damsels in distress. He simply writes that with this man called Arthur, he sets his historical background. He says at the period that he came to that he was in Britain, which works out being about 500 AD, and he talks about a series of battles he fought. And that's it. He doesn't really go into them in any greater detail. We've got an Arthur there that's unfettered by myth and elaboration. And that's the King Arthur I went in search of.
Well, of course, that writing you've just referred to was actually very early compared, as you say, to the medieval era. But even prior to that, in the time when this figure called Arthur, if he did indeed live, several centuries before that, there's almost nothing remains of that time in terms of writing. If anything, you know, you can elaborate on this. There just wasn't that written tradition. I mean, prior to the Romans coming along, again, for the Celtic peoples and earlier, there wasn't this written tradition. So even the earliest writings are working with, you know, a sort of a piecemeal picture handed down over centuries as part of an oral tradition. So it's no surprise that by the time you get even to the medieval era, you've got this a bit like Chinese whispers, you know, these ideas that have been passed down, and each person that deals with the material seems to add their own twist.
Yes, it was. If Arthur existed around 500 AD, which is the period that all the stories set him, and the period that Nennius tells us, that is still, so Nennius is writing 830, so it's still 300 years. Arthur is 300 years before that. And that's a lot of time for a story to become embellished. And the reason, I think I better explain first why there was very few writings from that period. Firstly, it's because the country was in pretty much a state of anarchy in many parts. There was internal fighting between the various kingdoms of the Britons. There was not only invasions by Anglo-Saxons, you've also got invasions from the north, from the Scottish, the Picts, as they were known, who weren't actually ever part of the Roman Empire. They were moving south. You've got all sorts of problems. And in this, against this background, there was very few writings either made or have been preserved. Now, there are certain monks in monasteries who were writing things like the Nennius, who I mentioned, but not many of these actually survived because of the conditions. Now, in that period, we do have, in that 300-year period where, you know, before Nennius, we do have Arthur being referenced, but in what are known as war poems, Dark Age poems written about the kings and chieftains of Britain by their, if you like, their court poets or bards, as they were known. And these people would write poems about the battles and exploits of their leaders, which were based on fact. They were really the poetry was a way of trying to remember in rhyme form or in song form the exploits of leaders when there were very few written accounts. And it was a way of memorizing and passing on these stories of their heroic exploits. And many of these were then written down years later. And so there is some of the history of these early Dark Ages preserved in the form of these war poems. And quite a few of these mention Arthur, but they don't tell us where he came from. But one that particular theme that keeps recurring is that Arthur was the leader of the Britons at the time of a battle called the Battle of Badon, B-A-D-O-N. Now, Nennius refers to Arthur as being the leader of the Britons at the Battle of Badon. And we know that this was an historical event because one of the writings that has survived was by another monk called Gildas. Now, he wrote in North Wales somewhere in the west of Britain around about the year 545 AD. That's pretty, we know pretty much when he did write because he refers to events in British history which have been dated from other sources. So he's writing within living memory of the period Arthur is said to have lived. So this is very important historical source. And he tells us that the Battle of Badon was a genuine historical battle, a crucial conflict between the Britons and the Anglo-Saxons, fought somewhere probably around about the city of Bath, it is believed. And it was at a time when the Anglo-Saxons were threatening to cut Britain pretty much in two, dividing their forces before ultimately conquering them. And there's this pivotal battle at Badon in which the Britons were victorious and drove the Anglo-Saxons back into the east of the country for some decades to come. Now, this was an incredibly important battle. Somebody of immense power from the British side was in charge, but sadly, Gildas, writing in the living memory of this battle, fails to name who this leader is. So we know it's a genuine battle, but the only name that's then associated with the Battle of Badon after that, in these war poems and mentioned by Nennius, is Arthur. So that kind of makes it, well, we certainly know what we're being told about Arthur in the early Dark Ages is that he was the leader at Badon, at the most crucial period of the war between the Saxons and the British. And the only name to be associated with that is Arthur, and we know it's an historical event. So it kind of adds credence to the fact that he definitely existed, and we know when he did.
Well, of course, another problem here is, and this comes across very much in your book, is names given to historical figures or even mythical figures. And, you know, there's individuals in your work sometimes, maybe like you've got a dozen different names depending on what source. And it makes it a very, very tricky and, you know, labyrinthine sort of detective story to try and unwind. And then you've got place names, of course, anything involving a name, essentially. And then you can get dates. Not only could recording of dates be handled differently by different chroniclers, but then you've got people using different calendars. And after a while, you can start to see potential for the story to be there kind of hidden in plain sight. But it's just a question of, as it quite often is in detective work, you know, of just sort of looking at the whole thing from a different angle, you know, and sort of saying, well, if we allow this, then what happens? And just running different scenarios. And it's incredibly complex picture.
Yeah, well, what I've had to try and do is to use different pieces of a jigsaw, put them together and get some kind of clear picture. So I'm using historical sources, like the documents I was talking about, plus archaeology. Now, when we're coming to the date, for example, of Arthur around about 500 AD, we have Nennius, firstly, who tells us that Arthur starts to fight the Anglo-Saxons when an Anglo-Saxon king called Hengist dies. Now, the Anglo-Saxons' own records, preserved in a manuscript called the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, written during the Dark Ages, refer to this event as having taken place in the early 490s. So we know that Arthur is active around the 490s. Then we have the monk Gildas, who tells us that about the Battle of Badon. We know he ruled around about 545 AD, because he references events that are datable from other sources, like the death of a king, for example, or a certain church event having taken place that we know from other sources happened at around that time. He tells us that the Battle of Badon happened 44 years before the time of his writing. He says it was also the year of his birth. So we're talking around about somewhere like 501. And you start adding all these bits together and you get a pretty clear picture that around about 500, Arthur is said to have existed. And then you add archaeology to that. And you find that archaeology can date certain places and events by discoveries made at sites, battles and so forth, or when buildings were erected. And that's done in a number of ways. There's radiocarbon dating, which is a scientific method of dating how long ago a particular organic piece of material died, i.e. bone from an animal, wood from a tree. They can date that to within a certain amount of decades. And there's the main method of dating is pottery sequencing. There are ways of dating pottery by comparing it with pottery found elsewhere. But one thing that can be done with pottery is called photoluminescence. It can be dated scientifically how long ago a piece of pottery was fired in the kiln. So you add all those things together and you find that certain battles were probably fought around a certain time based on the archaeological evidence. You couple that with the evidence that we have from the historical sources, and it pretty much, what we know pretty much for certain is round about 500 AD, give or take a couple of years, there was a major victory by the Britons over the Anglo-Saxons, and they were pushed back into the east. Now, somebody seems to have been bringing together the disunited British kingdoms of this period. Somebody was organizing this, a powerful leader that Britain didn't have before that. And the character that this is said to be in earliest myths, legends, or references is Arthur. So that's kind of why I'm thinking, well, if there's not a man called Arthur, there certainly seems to be somebody who's doing what Arthur is said to have done at the time he is said to have done it. And so that's the figure I was really looking for.
Well, you touch upon the, you know, for example, that the life and times of the figure known as Jesus Christ, you know, was that one person? Was it a person at all? But there's some parallels here in the sense that, you know, for some people, you know, the figure of Christ is just unquestioned. Of course, this man lived and died. You know, of a world religion, you know, that's pretty
right.
So you've got all of that weight of history. And then you've got other people who just say, oh, well, stuff and nonsense, of course, you know, son of God, you know, I'm an atheist, whatever. It's all just hokum. And then I've read certainly about some of the archaeological evidence that supports the existence of some of the locations mentioned in the New Testament, for example. So I just bring this up in the sense, you know, in the context of it, what we can and cannot say for certain about the distant past, but trying to get away from emotional or ideological positions that colour what we're looking at, if you see what I mean. You know, and in terms of Arthur, there are people who, you know, want Arthur to have existed as Arthur and have done these things, even if they are the medieval romantic things. And there are people who dismiss the very idea of Arthur ever being a historical figure, again, for their own personal reasons. But just as in we're talking about Christ or Muhammad or any other historical figure, religious or otherwise, that you can think of, it's trying to unpick the all that emotional, intellectual, and mainly ideological stuff from that and say, what have we actually got? What can we infer? And what is a logical extension from that, even if we can't prove it? A bit like in science, you know, what can we say? Well, you know, if A is true, then B might be true. And if we allow that, and this doesn't mean we can draw hard conclusions, but it might help us to move forward.
We do know that there was somebody uniting the Britons against the Anglo-Saxons. The evidence that this was Arthur is pretty much the same as the evidence there is outside the Bible for the existence of Jesus. It was written after the event. The Bible as we know it was written after the event by people who had a particular prejudice, if you like. The same thing goes for King Arthur. In my investigations, I'd say the historical and archaeological evidence for King Arthur is probably no more or less than there exists for the historical evidence for Jesus. But there are many people who wouldn't doubt that Jesus existed. Whether he actually did the miracles attributed in the Bible is a matter of faith. Whether King Arthur actually fought dragons and rescued damsels in distress is, again, a matter for those who might be into that kind of thing. But I'm trying to look really at what the historical evidence says. And I was quite prepared to accept when I started this investigation, if the man who was in charge of leading the Britons at this time turned out to be somebody other than Arthur, then so be it. My book would be equally, as I believe it, definitive in showing that there was not an Arthur, because the person who was supposed to rule when Arthur ruled was somebody different altogether. And in order to try and get my head around that, I thought, what do we know now archaeologically about where Arthur might have come from? Because these earliest references to him, like in Nennius, they don't tell us where he came from. So, okay, let's look at the archaeological side. So we know the period he's thought to have lived, around 500 AD. And Arthur, in all the early stories, is said to have ruled from somewhere called Camelot. Okay, now, if there is a place called Camelot in England, or something that sounds like that, should we be looking there? Unfortunately, no, because the name Camelot was an invention of a French poet called Chrétien de Troyes in the late 1100s. All before that period, There are references to Arthur ruling Britain from a magnificent and impregnable city, but it doesn't give its name. It seems that by the time these stories were committed in writing in the later Dark Ages, the name of this place had long been forgotten. But okay, if there was a man who united the Britons at the time Arthur is said to have done this, he obviously had some pretty powerful, impressive city somewhere, or at least some kind of capital. Where could this have been? So that was my first part of the search. Now, at the end of Roman Britain, in the early 400s, the four most important and powerful, if you want, cities in the country were London, Lincoln, York, and a place called Viriconium. Now, London and Lincoln and York were all invaded by the Anglo-Saxons pretty early on, because they're all in the east of Britain, which left this place called Viriconium as the pretty much the capital of Britain in the post-Roman era. And this is situated pretty much smack bang in the middle of England, or in the middle of Britain, closer to Wales, between the Welsh and English borders, a few miles away from there. But as far as Britain is concerned, which includes England and Wales, it's pretty much in the centre of the landmass. So because it's there, it is far more defendable, a far better place to organise the various kingdoms around the country, far better than those in the east, which, as I said, had already been invaded by the Anglo-Saxons. So this becomes the capital of Dark Age Britain. Now, unlike London, Lincoln and York, which are still modern cities, Viriconium never continued to be a city once it was eventually abandoned. And so all that remains of it now are the ruined walls in isolated countryside, about 4 miles to the east of the town of Shrewsbury in central England. And whereas it's been very difficult to excavate Roman Britain, the Britain of post-Roman period in London, because you'd have to dig under streets and office blocks and houses, because Viriconium survives in open countryside, a lot of archaeology has been able to take place there. And the archaeological excavations over the last 20 years have shown that not only was this place the most sophisticated and profitable city in Britain in the late 400s, early 500s, but around that period it was completely rebuilt and re-fortified at a time when many other ex-Roman towns were being abandoned for more easily defendable hill forts. So somebody around 500 AD greatly refortified, rebuilt this prosperous city. But not only that, right at the heart of this new thriving town, there was a palace or a residence built for somebody of extreme importance. It appeared to be, the archaeologists tell us, the seat of an important British warlord. Now, as this appears to be the capital of Britain at the time, or effectively the most important city, at the time Arthur is said to have ruled from the most important city in the country, I believe that from the archaeological perspective, Viriconium was the most likely place to look for an historical Camelot.
Funny enough, this reminds me of how the Arthur industry has sprung up in the same way that there's some industries based around lots of historical figures.
Well, there is. I mean, Robin Hood in Nottingham, for example.
Well, that's a great example. You could, even when you're driving down, is it the A1 still today? You know, you drive past the edge of Nottingham Forest. If you stop, as I did once, on the hard shoulder, get out of the car and cross the field and go into it, and it's not long before. I mean, Nottingham Forest is still substantial, but pretty quickly you run out of trees, and it's not really the time when England, would have been almost impenetrable because it was one big forest. But early on, there was this exploitation of Arthur's legacy, if we can call it that. In your book, you mentioned the Glastonbury tomb, the 1191 thing with the at Glastonbury Abbey, and that was sort of almost capitalising just him as a historical figure, the fact that he might have been associated with that place. And that actually goes on to this very day, which is remarkable, given that this was prior to the medieval romances that we spoke of earlier. And talking about Viriconium, as little known, again, I hadn't actually heard of this before I read your book, which is quite surprising even to myself. But you've got Tintagel Castle in Cornwall, for example, which actually looks a lot like one of the locations in John Burman's Excalibur. You've got claims to Arthurian fame dotted around Britain for various reasons. It seems that all you have to do is, and there's that the stone as well down in Cornwall somewhere, isn't there? Which has had a lot of press attention in recent years. I did a Google search and that popped up, you know, with lots of local newspapers doing items on that. And it seems that you've got a lump of rock that you can, or similar, that you can associate with this legend. And all you got to do is open a cafe and a gift shop and put up a sign and, you know, print a few tickets and have a few coach parties from wherever. And you're in business. And it just shows the power of these things. And it's not just about money, you know, because we spend money on all sorts of like intangible, bizarre things, and we can get other people to do the same. But there's just this, it's just so powerful. It is almost like a religion in a way.
The whole of the Arthur industry, as you said, down in Cornwall, they've got King Arthur gift shops and all sorts of things. And in Glastonbury, which is in the southwest of England, you've got a massive tourist industry of shops all around the place that sell Arthurian memorabilia based on the fact that that's where he's supposed to have been buried. It's incredible. But before I actually started to look elsewhere in the country for Arthur, I thought, well, I'd better have a look into these places, particularly Glastonbury. You say that Tintagel in Cornwall looks very similar to one of the sites in the John Borman film. It is, because it was filmed there. And in the 1100s, another monk, it was mainly just monks that were writing in the early Middle Ages and the Dark Ages. Nobody else knew how to write. And he writes that King Arthur, he writes one of the first of these Arthurian romantic stories. And he tells us that King Arthur was born at Tintagel in Cornwall, at that very castle that you're talking about, which is used, or the ruins of it, which is there now, which is used in as a set for Excalibur, where Arthur is born. But the problem is that archaeological evidence has shown that that castle was only built in the early 1100s. It didn't exist 600 years earlier when Arthur is said to have been born. One could say, well, you know, it was a site where somebody, an earlier place where Arthur was born. In fact, the archaeology has shown that previous to that, it was the site of a monastery, which would appear to be the unlikely place for the birth of anyone. But when you look at Geoffrey of Monmouth, he had good reason to say that Arthur was born in Tintagel. He does invent a lot of the themes that the King Arthur romances have in common throughout the Middle Ages. Kind of makes Arthur out to be more of this knight in shining armor and that kind of like person with who obeyed the laws of chivalry and so forth. That's a purely medieval concept. A historical Arthur wouldn't have been like that. He would have been more of a late Roman style warrior, maybe not even a Christian. But Geoffrey of Monmouth was patronized, in other words, he was sponsored, paid to write his book about King Arthur by the brother of the Earl of Cornwall, who, at the time that he wrote in the 1130s, actually owned that castle in Tintagel. In fact, it was he who had it built. So it's, in other words, he probably, Geoffrey of Monmouth, put the Tintagel, Arthur being born there, in his narrative as a way of pleasing the brother of his wealthy patron. So I kind of tended to discard that. I mean, Arthur could have been born there. Who knows where he was born? But I didn't see any real historical evidence for it. Glastonbury, I think I can really discount that one, because that is said to be where Arthur was buried. And it all comes down to the discovery made by the monks of the abbey in the 1190s, when there'd been a fire at Glastonbury Abbey in 1187. And it had pretty much burnt to the ground, or at least the wooden parts of it had. And the monks were digging around in the foundations, trying to reconstruct something of a new abbey. And while they were doing this, they claimed to have found a grave, which contained the remains of two people, plus a cross that says, "Here lies King Arthur. Here lies the renowned King Arthur in the Isle of Avalon with his second wife, Guinevere." Which is interesting, because some of the earliest tales suggested Arthur had more than one wife, but that was lost in the later romances. So there's this lead cross inscribed that was found put in the grave with these bodies that said, in Latin, "Here lies the renowned King Arthur, in the Isle of Avalon with his second wife, Guinevere. Well, was this genuine or was it a hoax by the monks? There is no evidence that anybody writing about Glastonbury Abbey before this discovery ever associated Glastonbury with King Arthur or the Isle of Avalon, which in legend is where Arthur is said to have been buried. And secondly, it was very fortuitous that the monks found King Arthur's bones, because the bones of saints or important warriors or people from history were considered in the Middle Ages to have spiritual power. You could be close to them, you could be cured of sickness, you could receive enlightenment or whatever else, and they were known as relics. And when they were put on display in an abbey or a cathedral that was there for everyone to see, pilgrims would come in the hope of being cured or gaining inspiration or whatever else they hoped for by being close to these remains. And the abbeys that had the remains of the most celebrated historical figure or saint had more pilgrims who came and brought donations, hence they got more of a medieval tourist trade. And if one thing the Abbey of Glastonbury needed after the fire was a tourist trade, they wanted people coming to that abbey to give donations to pay for its rebuilding. And finding Arthur's remains was pretty fortuitous for this. But when you look into the fact that look into the records of the abbey of that time, you find that King Arthur's remains weren't the first ones these monks claimed to have found when digging around in the rubble of the burnt down building. They firstly claimed to have found the bones of Saint Patrick, and they put those on display. And then, of course, the church in Ireland really started complaining about this, because they said, "Hold on, Saint Patrick's been buried here for centuries." There was such an outcry that those remains disappeared. Then they claimed to have dug up another saint that was there, St. Dunstan, who was an Archbishop of Canterbury, an important English saint. Well, of course, the current Archbishop of Canterbury complained about this. The church didn't like that. So those remains were quietly removed. And then after that, a couple of years later, we've got King Arthur's remains. No one really made any fuss about that, because he wasn't a church figure. So they put those on display, and the abbey was saved, because tourists or pilgrims came flocking from around the country, and it was rebuilt as the second biggest abbey in all of England outside Canterbury. So I was suspicious that these monks may have made the whole thing up. And of course, the bones nor the cross survive today for us to examine. But the cross is pretty suspicious, because it says, "Here lies the renowned, or famous, if you like, King Arthur on the Isle of Avalon." First, why bother to tell anyone it's the Isle of Avalon? Presumably anybody who lived there, if it had been the Isle of Avalon, would have known that. And why put the renowned King Arthur? When Queen Elizabeth I died, she wasn't put in a tomb and a stone laid on top of it to say, "Here lies the famous Queen Elizabeth." I mean, that's just... the whole thing sounds like it's been made up. So that's why I tended to disregard Glastonbury as well and look elsewhere. But the fact was, historically, King Arthur was used in the Middle Ages as just as much of a tourist attraction as he is today.
This suddenly put me in mind of, I'm sure you've noticed the fuss they had when they turned up the remains of Richard III underneath a car park in Leicester. And immediately there started a bit of a bum fight about where these remains were going to go. I think it's fairly safe to say that there was, Richard III was a real person who lived and did his deeds and died. But I live here in York, and there was a bid here in order to get the remains moved over here, saying, "Oh, we've got a case to have him here." And that didn't work out. The remains are now interred in Leicester. But we still have the Richard III experience, which you can go to here in York, which is basically a gift shop on the city walls, you know. So we say, if we can't have the remains,
sure. We want a gift shop.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But, well, perhaps we should walk through some of the other elements. We've, you know, mentioned Camelot. You've already mentioned Avalon, actually. But some of the other key elements of the story, and see what you turned up. I mean, Avalon itself involved a lot of legwork for you and a lot of consideration about possible sites, because you have, I mean, Avalon, you say the Isle of Avalon, you have dozens and dozens of offshore islands off the British Isles, but you also have lots of islands in lakes within Britain, I should say, not the British Isles, it takes in Ireland. So, and trying to, again, try to match up some of what you were reading about, some of what you were unearthing with potential candidates that are out there. And given the fact that, of course, that the landscape continues to change over the centuries and millennia, you know, so things are not as they might have been centuries and millennia ago.
Well, it seems that the Arthur, it was Avalon. I mean, in the story of Arthur, he is mortally wounded in a final battle, fighting his nephew in a civil conflict. As he lies dying on the field of battle, he asks his knight, Bedivere, to cast his sword Excalibur, which is his symbol of office, into a nearby lake. And when a knight eventually does this, the arm from a mysterious nymph-like woman called the Lady of the Lake rises from the surface, grabs the weapon by the hilt, and takes it down into the crystal depths. Now, that is the story of how Arthur's sword ends up in a lake. The knight goes back to Arthur. When he returns to Arthur, a short distance away, Arthur has been taken by three mysterious maidens, one of whom we're told is the Lady of the Lake, and put into a barge, a boat, and sailed to the Isle of Avalon for his wounds to be tended. But eventually he dies there, and the legend goes that that's where he's buried. Well, to me, this suggests that if this legend was actually based in any way on any kind of truth that had been romanticized over the years, the Avalon, where Arthur is taken to, seems to be over a lake and not the sea. And in other words, the lake where the Lady of the Lake grabs Excalibur is the same lake across which Avalon lies, because of a number of things. Firstly, wherever the knight throws the sword into the, you know, he stands on the shores of the lake, throws the sword, is very close, within walking distance of where Arthur is lying dying. When he gets back, the Lady of the Lake, who swum under the water and grabbed hold of the weapon, has returned to take Arthur onto this boat and sailed him across to Avalon. Whether we believe in the Lady of the Lake or whether we believe in any of the actual events that surround Arthur's death, the idea seems to be that Avalon is in the middle of a lake in the early stories, not across the sea. So that helped me kind of like narrow things down a little bit. And there are many, there were many places in the Dark Ages in Britain where you'd got lakes with islands in the middle that became sacred places, originally pagan sacred places, but then later turned into monasteries as the country became more Christianized. And a lot of these islands were sacred to a particular water goddess who has different names in different places, but one of her names is Viviana. And the name of the Lady of the Lake in the early Arthurian romances is called Vivian. So I'm beginning to think that here we have a kind of story of a mythical or pagan religious goddess, deity, who becomes a figure associated with King Arthur as the story is more embellished. But what really is interesting, I mean, I kind of thought, first of all, when I investigated the story of King Arthur, that the Excalibur and Lady of the Lake theme was probably the least likely to actually have any basis in history at all. But I was proved very much wrong, because writings by the Romans tell us that the Celtic people of Britain and northern France, and an island incident that we find out from archaeological evidence, in the early Dark Ages, when a person was dying, part of the funeral ritual was to, if they were a famous warrior, was to cast their sword into a lake as an offering to a water deity, a water goddess, as an offering to assure them safe passage to the underworld. Gradually, as paganism was replaced by Christianity, this tradition became throwing swords or other precious possessions to a saint associated with that particular stretch of water. That some people later continued this tradition, throwing coins and other objects into sacred lake pools or springs, which is incidentally where the tradition of water wishing wells comes from. So when if there's a historical Arthur and he's dying around about 500 AD, it could be very possible that his sword was thrown into a sacred lake as an offering to a water goddess or an early saint as part of his funeral. So, and then that could have gradually become embellished into the story of a lady of the lake, this strange nymph-like creature, as time went by. But what was really interesting from my point of view is that that story, because of, I mean, we know not only do we know this happened because of what Roman writers tell us, archaeology has proven it. Many of these early lakes with islands, sacred islands in them, have been dried out over the years, as you mentioned, for they've been drained for reclaiming farmland. And so there's many dried up lakes that have allowed archaeologists to excavate, and they've found many items that have been cast by the Celtic people of the Dark Ages into these once lakes as offerings to some deity or other. And they must have been offerings and not just discarded, because they're precious objects, and they include many swords. So we know that this happened. We've got the Romans telling us this has happened at the end of the Roman period, and we've got the archaeology demonstrating that this happened. So because that's real, I tend to believe this story in some way, that Arthur was taken to an island to be buried in the middle of a lake, as being well worthy of investigation.
Yes, well, this idea of the votive offerings, as you say, casting things into water, is very important, because it's interesting when you find something like that. As you say, you thought that was perhaps the most fanciful aspect of the legend, and yet here it is tied to something very concrete and very real, and something that lives on today in a sort of changed form. What about a couple of the other figures in the story? I mean, we've got a lot to choose from here. For example, Arthur's half-sister, we'll use the term Morgana Le Fay. Again, I'm just plucking the term that I'm most familiar with from the tales. And her son, Mordred, or as I, the first time I've seen an alternate spelling of that actually was in your book, Mordred, possibly. And then you have the rest of the so-called love triangle from the Arthurian romances of the medieval period, you know, Lancelot and Guinevere. And you've already addressed Guinevere up to a point. So give us some, what you discovered about the potential existence or otherwise of some of these other figures, you know, who they might have been and how their relationships might have made any sense in the context of the Arthur story, whether the concrete one that you're beginning to unearth, or indeed, you know, the kind of the legend, the fantasy legend.
In order to find out who Arthur's associates were, I think the first thing I needed to do was to really pin down who he was, because I've got a location for him, if you remember earlier, Viriconium, and I've got a time for him, 500 AD. So were the records that told us who ruled there from around 500 AD? If I could find out who he was, did the records also tell us if he had a wife, if he had a sister, if her name was Morgana, and if he had a nephew called... incidentally, you mentioned the other early spelling, Modred, instead of Mordred. That was the earliest spelling. Mordred is what his name becomes in the Middle Ages. So was there an historical Modred? So is there any records anywhere of who ruled from Viriconium? There are. And they survive in the British Library in London. And they, in the series of a series of genealogies attached to a manuscript called the Welsh Annals, although it's the Welsh Annals, it refers to events throughout the whole of Britain, not only in Wales. And there are a series of genealogies, in other words, family trees, of the kings of the various kingdoms throughout Britain. Because remember I said Britain are divided up into separate, often feuding kingdoms. And it talks about who these kings were and mentions a lot of their relations as well, their relatives. And it does tell us who ruled from Viriconium around the year 500 AD. So I thought, this is it. We're going to find the first evidence of King Arthur. But sadly, when I looked at these early genealogies that were committed to writing in the Dark Ages, I find that the man who ruled from Viriconium at the time Arthur is said to have ruled was called Owen Than Gwyn. Now, he does fit into the Arthur kind of background, because he was, whereas Arthur in the historical stories in the Middle Ages was overthrown by his nephew, or at least the two of them ended up killing each other, but the kingdom was brought down by his nephew, who was known as Mordred, or earlier Modred. This man, Owen Fenguin, was overthrown by his nephew, whose name was Maelgwyn. So he fits the kind of Arthur story in that respect. He had a wife, but we don't know what her name was. So unfortunately, that doesn't really help. And there isn't somebody called Lancelot involved in the family, but there is somebody called Lud. Now, the word Lud in early Brythonic, which was a language spoken in Britain at the time, means there is a figure in Celtic mythology of Lud of the Silver Lance. He's a figure, and the word Lud was often, he's a mythological figure, and the word Lud was often applied to a lance. So I know it might be a bit of a jump, but the person, he has a person involved with his entourage who could have eventually been given the name Lancelot. He is overthrown by his nephew. So maybe the whole thing came about gradually through mythology and it twisted together the facts, and the real Arthur was lost in history. And he might have been this character, Owen Fenguin. That was where I was left until I decided again to read the monk Gildas, the one who tells us, who wrote within living memory of Arthur's time. He tells us about the Battle of Badon and this very important battle between the Anglo-Saxons and the Britons, of which the Angles were eventually pushed back, but fails to name their leader. He does refer to a number of British leaders around the year 500, and he refers to Owen Fenguin, but he doesn't call him just by his name, Owen Fenguin. He refers to him by his battle name. Now, a battle name was something the Celts regularly did at that time. Somebody who was an important warrior, chieftain, would often be given the name of a real or mythical animal in some way representing their prowess, like cunning fox or an eagle, somebody you could see well. The person, Owen Fenguin, who ruled Viriconium in 500 AD, Gildas refers to him by the Latin name, because he was writing in Latin, Ursus, which means the bear. So we know that Owen Thanguin's battle name was the bear, and I decided to try and find out what that would be in Brythonic, the language spoken at the time. Now, in Brythonic, and actually still preserved in modern Welsh, which derives from Brythonic, the name for a bear, and you can look this up in any dictionary online or anywhere else, the Welsh and Old Brythonic word for a bear is Arth, A-R-T-H. And I thought, oh my God, this has got to be the figure. Not only does the person who ruled from Viriconium, the most powerful city in the country, when Arthur is supposed to rule from the most powerful city in the country, have somebody associating with him with the name Lance, who was overthrown by his nephew, his title was Arth, which could easily have become Arthur when it was Latinized and gradually used more often throughout the centuries. So as far as I'm concerned, by finally sort of putting names to names, if you like, I had found, I am convinced, an historical figure that qualifies for the real King Arthur.
Now, what about the idea that we've touched upon in passing of Arthur as Roman, or certainly more Roman-like? Because, of course, when the Roman Empire split into two around 395, and that Romans were more or less out of Britain by 410, they were and they weren't. For example, they've been here for hundreds of years. Many people from all over the empire had ended up in Britain, had settled here. And they didn't all just leave. They had families. And of course, a lot of people, Britons born free, i.e. not as slaves, had Roman citizenship. And many thought of themselves as Roman. So it's not just a simple cut-off. And I remember seeing that film, I don't know if you saw it in 2004, simply called King Arthur. And that recast the whole mythical legend, you know, the whole idea as Arthur, indeed, as a Roman officer. And in the film, they base it on this character called Lucius Artorius Castus, who apparently was an actual Roman officer. So what did you find in terms of links there? The reason I bring this up now is because thinking of the figure of Merlin again, and where he comes in, thinking about this figure Ambrosius now. So What can we infer? What can we maybe learn? What new pointers might we gain if we start to look at, you know, Arthurian Britain as a continuum from Roman Britain and not just this cut-off?
The period at the end of Roman Britain sees Britain pretty much intact. The Romans leave in 410 AD when their empire is collapsing. And the Roman Empire doesn't fully collapse in the West until the 470s. So the Romans had ruled Britain for 300 years, so Britain was pretty much completely Romanized. It gradually fell more into anarchy. But the kind of weaponry and the kind of buildings and the kind of defenses that the Britons had at the period Arthur is said to have existed were Roman style. They weren't like in the Middle Ages, as the film John Borman's Excalibur shows, is that Arthur was considered to be a knight in shining armor, wearing the kind of plate armor that wasn't invented until the medieval period. He lives in a huge Gothic castle, the kind of thing that wasn't built until the medieval period. Now, Arthur lived many hundreds of years before this. At that point, they didn't have knights in shining armor, and they didn't have castles. What they had was warriors who were dressed in a Roman style. If you saw an Arthurian warrior and you saw a Roman warrior, you probably wouldn't be able to tell the difference, except the Arthurian warrior were probably a bit more scruffy. The kind of defenses they generally had were wooden stockades. A city or a fortification would be surrounded by embankments and ditches, and on top of those embankments were timber stockades with watchtowers. Some places had brick buildings, but most of these defences were built so that they could be patrolled by trained armies, and that's what the Romans had. So these were the sort of defences. So in other words, rather than living in a huge Gothic castle, and rather than being a knight in shining armour, the historical Arthur and his warriors would have been Roman-style soldiers operating out of wooden fortifications, generally speaking, rather than big Gothic castles. Now, the reason why during the Middle Ages King Arthur is depicted as a knight in shining armor and living in a Gothic castle is because during the Middle Ages people didn't know what life was like a few hundred years earlier. When the medieval writers portray the legends of Greece and Rome or biblical stories, they depict their characters in a medieval setting, a setting of knighthood and chivalry. In fact, if you look at any medieval painting of the crucifixion, you will see that the people standing around the cross are dressed like medieval people. They didn't know at that time. It was years later when history became established as a subject and archaeology developed that people began to really know what Romans had really looked like. And that, so consequently, this is why Arthur in the medieval stories is depicted out of an historical context. He's an anachronism. He wears plate armor and he fights with a lance and a big broadsword, when in reality he wouldn't have been anything like that. And again, that is another reason why historians say this figure with knight and of armor and so forth couldn't have lived. Well, no, he couldn't. But somebody behind that story who was Romanized and who lived in fortifications of a Roman style probably gave birth to this original legend.
And so does the legend of this figure Merlin also emerge from that world?
There is a figure, but Merlin is a... I've written a whole separate book about Merlin, and really I can't do him a lot of justice in a couple of minutes, but he does seem to be a genuine figure. He seems to have been based on a character called Ambrosius Aurelius, a Roman officer who led the Britons at one point before Arthur, but then had to retire. And when he retired for injury or because he was too old, he became an advisor to Arthur. And there is this historical figure called Ambrosius Aurelius. He appears in historical records of that time. And the earliest references to Merlin refer to him once having the name Ambrosius. And he adopts the name Merlin, which actually means an eagle, which is again another example of somebody using a title of an animal. And becomes an advisor to Arthur, and that's how the legend builds up. But it's, Merlin is an interesting figure because in the Arthurian story, he's the real kind of guiding influence behind the throne. It's him who first takes Arthur to the Lady of the Lake to receive his sword Excalibur. Incidentally, the sword in the stone is a completely separate sword, although the John Borman film puts Excalibur and the sword in the stone as one and the same. They are actually different. Arthur uses one sword to prove his kingship, and another sword actually symbolizes his kingship and gives him a certain amount of invulnerability. That's Excalibur. It's Merlin who first tells people of the existence of Avalon. Now, remember I said that Avalon historically seems to have been an island in a lake. Well, Merlin knows of this island, and it seems to be from Merlin that we're told that Arthur must be buried on Avalon. Now, if he is based on this historical figure, Ambrosius Aurelius, then he knew Britain before Arthur's time. He got to know the people and he got to know the practices of the religious priesthood, if you like, the druids as they were called, or bards in later period. So where would an historical Ambrosius have known an Avalon really existed? Because remember, my whole idea was to try and find the tomb of the person behind the Arthur legend. That's why the book is called The Lost Tomb of King Arthur. So I had to try and find out where this figure, Owen Thangwyn, was actually buried. Because I believed he was the real Arthur. It had to be somewhere, presumably, that Ambrosius Aurelius would have known about or been associated with. Now, I won't go into the whole of this because, again, I had to write a whole book about this as a separate issue. But Ambrosius Aurelius is known to have been associated with an area to the north of where Viriconium now lies. So I was kind of searching in that area for an island in a lake. Luckily, I came upon Merlin also, we are told, wrote a series of poems about the period in which he lived, some of which have survived. There were other people that Merlin is said to have trained as poets, and they wrote a series of poems which survived, and the tradition carried on. Now, one of these war poems that it has been dated from the early Dark Ages, that is in the, if you like, the Merlin bardic tradition, talks about where Arthur, talks about where the kings who rule from Viriconium are laid to rest. And they tell us that one of these kings was actually, at least one of these kings we're told, is a descendant of Arthur, which suggests that it's also telling us that Arthur's buried here. But we know for a fact that these Merlin bardic poems refer to Owen Thangwyn being buried at a place in this area, which I'd already identified with Ambrosius, a place called the Churches of Bassa, right smack bang in the middle of this area, about 8 miles to the north of Viriconium. There is a village today called Bass Church. Churches of Bassa, Bass Church, it has to be the same place. And right outside the village, which is today called Bass Church, there is a hillock which, during the period that Arthur is said to have lived, would have been surrounded completely by water, making it an island. And a lot of that lake has now been dried up. It's been drained for farmland. But it's now known as the Birth, from an old Welsh word meaning beautiful. And it's known from the limited archaeology that's been done there to have been in use as some kind of ceremonial site at the time that Arthur is said to have lived, at the time the historical Owen Thangwyn lived. So I've got a lake island with sacred associations, which I know from these early poems is where the kings of Viriconium were buried. Owen Thangwyn is buried there. If Owen Thangwyn is Arthur, then I know for certain that King Arthur is buried on an island in a lake, just as King Arthur is said to have been done in the Middle Ages. And that all came from investigating the legend of Merlin.
What has been, overall, the reaction to your findings? Because, as we said before, this is, to say the least, not without controversy, this area of research.
The first reaction I got was when I first said to archaeologists and historians, I think that this particular place is where Arthur is buried. First of all, they said, well, oh no, I mean, you know, this is, you can't say that. That this based on Dark Age war poem that, I mean, you've already admitted yourself it's got associations with Merlin, and Merlin's a completely mythological figure. And I said, no, he isn't. This is associated with Ambrosius Aurelius, who we know as an historical figure, who became known as Merlin in later stories, but this doesn't stop the fact that these early Dark Age poems refer to this place as a burial site of the kings of that area. So, you know, that's got to be real, hasn't it? And they say, well, no, there's no evidence it really was a burial site. That was probably just made up. So I thought, right, the only way to prove this is to have an archaeological excavation or some sort of investigation of the area to prove that it was a burial site dating from the period that Arthur is said to have lived. Now, one of the kings in one of these poems, a man called Cwnthalin, is said to be buried in a very specific place at the churches of Bassa. It's said to have been an acre in size, and there is like an acre field on this mound thing in the middle of what was once a lake, the island, that matches completely the description. An archaeologist said, no, yeah, they're obviously using that location as a setting for the poem, but it doesn't mean to say there's anybody really buried there. And I said, okay, if I could prove that that was a burial site, would you take seriously the other claim within this poem that Owen Thangwyn is buried there? And therefore, if Owen Thangwyn could be an historical Arthur, it's worth excavating. They said, yeah, if you could prove that, that would be something. I managed to organise, and this took considerable expense one way or another, a geophysics survey of this acre area where this particular king is said to have been buried. We knew what we were, a geophysics survey is basically using equipment like ground sensing radar that can look under the ground and produce a three-dimensional computer image of what lies buried. Now, we knew what we'd be looking for. The burials of that period, known from other archaeological sites, were in a pit, circular pit, about 6 foot deep and about 6 foot wide. At the bottom of these pits, the warrior, if a warrior or a king, was often buried lying on their side with a shield on their arm. Now, the archaeological survey took place over a whole day, involved lots of different geophysical equipment. And what was discovered, and the head archaeologist of the whole of that county in which that's in Shropshire, was involved in it too, and supervised the exploration, the geophysics survey. So it was all totally bona fide, all done by professional archaeologists, the very people who had been responsible for doing a dig. They looked at that particular area, and right in the middle of this acre of ground, they found evidence that there was a circular pit about 6 foot deep, and right in the middle of it appeared to be a ferrous object, a piece of iron, which they identified as the central boss, the central piece of a shield. It looked totally consistent with the burial site of an important person around about the year, in the early Dark Ages. They couldn't put the exact year to it, but of the style of early Dark Age burials. In other words, the poem was absolutely right about a particular king buried there. I'd met the requirements of proving that the poem shouldn't be ignored, so please now can we have a geophysics scan of the whole area to find out where Arthur, the historical Owen Thangwyn, might be buried, so we can have a look and then do an excavation. But then they said, oh, well, this in its own right doesn't prove anything. I thought, oh my, they keep changing the goalposts. Archaeologists are so frightened, like historians, to associate the name with King Arthur because so many people consider him to be a completely fairy tale character that they really do not want to be involved in any kind of historical investigation. But what I'd managed to do was to get that. Every time now that I confront them or anybody confronts them about, well, why won't you do this, dig? Why don't you get involved in this particular further geophysics scan of the area? They refuse to comment. So I've got them on the run. But it just goes back to showing you how the myth and legend, although it's kept Arthur alive and it's stopped him being forgotten, which is a great thing, it's also preventing us from finding out the final truth about him.
Well, just sort of a closing thought on that note, really, that whatever the reality of the situation, which I think we can both agree, you know, even the archaeologists that you referred to and on both sides of the argument, you know, very much wanting to explore this and very much wanting to drop it like the proverbial hot potato, could agree that whatever the reality of the legends or otherwise, that the life of any of the individuals concerned, if they lived real lives, would have been every bit as dramatic and exciting in their own way as any of the medieval romances. Because if you look at the medieval romances, I mean, the Arthurian legends, what are they? That they're the concerns that human beings have always had, you know, our joys and our sadnesses, our tragedies and our triumphs, just sort of writ large. And I would imagine if you or I were dropped back into 500 AD, we'd find it a pretty wild ride, and we wouldn't necessarily have need for magicians or mythical castles or magical swords or any of the rest of it. So you're right, the popular legends have kept Arthur alive, but I think that allowing that to get in the way of the history, which is our shared history, which is every bit as dramatic and mundane as well. And let's not forget that just because Hollywood films don't show people using the bathroom doesn't mean that it didn't have to happen. If you see what I mean. So yeah. there's a lot here that, and I think we denigrate history by simply, as fun as they are, by simply allowing the history to be viewed through the prism of popular culture.
Well, the King Arthur himself, or the person who united the Britons at the time that King Arthur is said to have lived, whoever it was, and the people living then in Britain, would have been not only fighting constant civil wars between these various kingdoms. Britain was something like Yugoslavia became after the collapse of communism. One kingdom, one area fighting another. In addition to that, you've got tribes of Angles, Saxons, and also Jutes that came from Denmark invading in the east. You've got Scots in the form of Picts invading from the north. And you've even got Irish invading in the west of Britain. So the country was a right old mess. After enjoying many years of civilization under the Romans, people were back to living in mud huts primarily, which would have probably made Sibiriconium almost a magical place because it was like a last vestige of civilization. So you can imagine that whoever lived there is living in this last vestige of civilization, surrounded by internecine strife, foreign invasion, poverty and starvation. And it's ever likely that whoever was living at this capital city of Britain at that time would have develop myths and legends about them that would have created them into being an almost magical group of people that others would have, well, could only have dreamt about.
Graham, today we've been talking about, as I mentioned at the top of the hour, your latest book, The Lost Tomb of King Arthur, The Search for Camelot and the Isle of Avalon. That's widely available, all the usual outlets. So just tell people about your website and anything else you'd like to share.
Yeah, well, you can find out everything on my website, really, which is grahamphillips.net, not .com, grahamphillips.net. And on the front page is a link, the first page you go into, the main page, homepage, there's all the links to all my books that I've written, and a couple of links on there. You just click on a picture of the book, and you'll get the information about it, the sort of things I've been talking about, plus pictures, and where to buy it. So it's grahamphillips.net.
Splendid. Well, Graham, thank you so much for joining us today on LegalizeFreedom.com.
Thank you very much for having me on, Greg.
Well, folks, that's it for another week. As ever, thank you so much for listening. If you enjoyed the show, check out the website, which is LegalizeFreedom.com. That's Legalize-Freedom.com, where you'll find an archive of programs offering alternative views on a wide range of topics, including politics and economics, energy and environment, culture, spirituality, history, and the nature of reality. You can also browse and buy a range of publications from our guests, and if you're feeling generous, make a donation to help keep the site up and running. Whether you listen, donate, or do both, I greatly appreciate your support. Until next time, I'm Greg Moffat, and you've been listening to LegalizeFreedom.com.